everyone, and welcome to Collider movie talk for movie fans. I'm your host, Ashley Mova, and this is the daily show where we give you all of the latest news from the world of movies, plus a little bit of insight into what it all means. Joining us, as always, is John Campia.
Greetings and salutations, everybody. Welcome to the best damn movie-related show on the internet, coming to you from right here at the Collider Video headquarters here in Burbank, California. And I think Ashley's hair is a bit darker today.
Oh, you noticed.
I can't be sure, but yeah. I think so.
Also, here is John Schnepp.
I think you're totally right. I think your hair is a little bit darker. Glad I noticed it. Totally noticed it yesterday.
Also, here is David Griffin.
I am noticing this lovely new green that we have all around us, lovely new studio here in Burbank. So this is great. Thanks for having me.
With Star Wars Episode 7 now less than 5 months away and production gearing up for 2016 Star Wars anthology Rogue One, not much attention has been paid to director Rian Johnson's 2017 Star Wars Episode 8. However, a new report from The Wrap is claiming that Lucasfilm has sent out an offer to Academy Award-winning actor Benicio Del Toro to play the villain in the film. Del Toro is no stranger to giant sci-fi epics, as he appeared in last year's Guardians of the Galaxy for Marvel. Star Wars Episode 8 is scheduled to hit theaters on May 26, 2017. John, if this report is true, how would you feel about Benicio Del Toro as the villain in Episode 8?
Well, okay, if it's true, that's a big if. So if this is true, I'm not sure how I feel about it, to be honest. Look, on the one hand, there's that one mantra I have. It is never a mistake to add talent. And Benicio Del Toro is clearly talent. He's got an Academy Award on his mantle for a reason. That being said, I mean, the spirit of the original Star Wars trilogy has been what J.J. Abrams has kind of been following along with. No big stars. And other than the original cast, they've gone with upcoming young talent who aren't household names. Adding a Benicio Del Toro now in the role of a villain, and I'll be honest, I love Guardians of the Galaxy. I wasn't thrilled with his incarnation of the Collector, necessarily. He had a couple of funny lines, but overall, I wasn't really thrilled with it. And how much of that was his fault and how much of that was James Gunn's direction, I'm not really sure. But I love the movie. It's just that I wasn't so great on it. So I'm torn. Terrific talent, so that's a good thing. Big name star, could that detract from the spirit of Star Wars? I'm not really sure. Give me a few days to think about it. And I'm sure by the time Jedi Council comes around, I'll have a more solid, firm feeling on it. But I think there's positives and negatives to this. I don't know, Schnepp, what do you think?
I say Peter Cushing, Christopher Lee, Samuel L. Jackson, and now Benicio Del Toro.
Yeah, don't talk to me about prequels.
I'm just saying, it's like, you know, they've had some big names like Sam Jackson and a bunch of, like, you know, people from the Hammer films, which are like Peter Cushing and Christopher Lee. So Benicio Del Toro, it depends on why they're casting him as a villain. If they want him to be like, have his, you know, regular style, like really hard to understand, kind of mushy, like, you know, like sometimes he does those kinds of characters, and sometimes he'll come through and bring a real good characterization. So I don't know. I'm kind of iffy about the character. I'm not so gung-ho about the casting, to be
David?
Honest.
I'm excited for it because Benicio is built for roles like this. The man is eternally going to have bags under his eyes. He wakes up looking like he stepped out of a bar like every single night. I mean, he's grained, but I mean, I think he looks good for that. I think he'd be a great villain. I think he'd be perfect for this. And yes, he does have that kind of hard to understand. He is a big name, but I don't think he's like a Brad Pitt or maybe like, you know, there was talk about putting Oprah as Amanda Waller. I don't think he would be that distracting compared to some other. He's a big name. But he's not as mainstream as I think we all perceive him as, just because, you know, he's such a talented actor.
It's funny that you mentioned Brad Pitt, because I was actually going to say that my favorite Benicio Del Toro performance, and he's had a number of amazing performances, but my favorite performance of his was in Snatch. Even though he wasn't in the movie a long time.
Frankie Fourfingers.
Oh, he's so good. And he developed this. I still don't know what that accent was. He had this weird blend of three different types of accents. He was hilarious in that. So, I mean, I don't want that as the villain in the Star Wars film. But still, he's capable of bringing some amazing stuff. So let's see how it turns out. All right, what's next?
As many of you will remember, last month, a tragic plane crash took the life of 7-time Academy Award-nominated composer James Horner, responsible for scoring films such as The Amazing Spider-Man, Titanic, Aliens, Apollo 13, A Beautiful Mind, and many others. Horner had recently been working with director Antoine Fuqua, scoring this week's Southpaw with Jake Gyllenhaal, and he was also supposed to score Fuqua's upcoming film, The Magnificent Seven Remake. However, Fuqua recently revealed in an interview that he just learned Horner had already written the score for the new film before he passed away. Fuqua said the following, "I just found out a few days ago. Horner's team flew out here to Baton Rouge, and they brought me all the music for The Magnificent Seven. He already wrote it for me based on the script. He did it all off the script because he wanted to surprise me. I thought it was a gift or something, and they all came out here and said, Antoine, James wrote the music for Magnificent Seven already, and it's just glorious. David, should Antoine Fuqua use the score James Horner composed for him for The Magnificent Seven?"
This is a tough question. This is a very tough question because, in a way, first off, the first thought that comes to your mind is you want to honor James Horner.
Sure.
Of course, use his music. Of course, look at his resume. Look at what he's done. I know for me as a kid, one of the first scores I ever heard was from Glory. It's going back over 20 years now. I believe that's where Denzel won his first Academy Award for Best Supporting Actor. And I remember clearly with the Harlem Boys Choir, that music, it's still in my head. I'm never going to get that out of my head. And I think you want to use his music, but does it fit the movie? There's a script, but then you look at the scenes, you look how everything sets up. If it doesn't fit, do you not use it, even if it is glorious? Because I think the key thing is what Ashley was saying from the interview is that they said it was glorious. We haven't heard the director say, like, yes, this is glorious. I want to use it. So I think this is a tough one. I mean, you want to honor James Horner, but what if it doesn't fit the movie?
Schnepp?
Yeah, that is a tough one. I would imagine, though, because they've worked together, and that he was so excited about it that he just went into it. So I can imagine that the score is amazing. So that's my guess is that Fuqua is going to want to use it, not only as like to honor James Horner, but I bet it's great.
Yeah, this is a very tough question because you're right. You want to honor James Horner. Ultimately, though, Antoine Fuqua's first responsibility is to make a great movie and make it as great as it can possibly be. Obviously, he already trusts James Horner. We got Southpaw coming out this weekend. Mm-hmm. That is an Antoine Fuqua film that was composed by James Horner. So obviously, he already trusts him, but Horner composed what he composed without seeing the visuals, without understanding how the scene's going to feel. He just wrote based on the script. I have a feeling what will probably happen here is that Fuqua will go out and get like a Michael Giacchino or, you know, or Hans Zimmer or somebody like that, right? And say, okay, you're going to be the one to actually see the film and understand how everything's supposed to feel. But can you base your work off of what James already composed? Take elements, take certain pieces of the score, take whatever, and integrate them in so it's still kind of James's in a way. It just seems like a good way to compromise on that at the balance of, I'm sure Antoine wants to honor James at the same time of making sure the movie is as good as it can possibly be. So probably it's going to end up being a little bit of a combination of the two. That would be my guess. But actually, I'd be really curious. This is a weird and a very, could be sensitive type of question. What do you guys think would be the right thing to do? If you were the producer of the film and you need your movie to be as good as it can be, would you just say, just use the score as James wrote it? Would you say just go with somebody totally different? Or would you say mix the two? I'm curious to know what your guys' thoughts would be. Leave your thoughts in the comment section below. All right, what's next?
A story in The Hollywood Reporter claims that Disney is planning a live-action remake of the 1963 animated film The Sword and the Stone. According to the report, Game of Thrones writer/producer Brian Cogman is set to write the script for the film, which is described as follows. Based on the T.H. White story from 1938, the feature tells the story of a young King Arthur named Wart in the original film and his training at the hand of the wizard Merlin, leading him to pull the enchanted sword from the stone and claim the throne of England. Schnepp, is The Sword in the Stone a good film to remake into live action?
Thou doth speaketh of Excalibur. Excalibur! Yes. Well, I cannot wait to see this. I love any live action storytelling of the King Arthur mythos, The Sword in the Stone, Lady in the Lake, all that stuff. So I think it's ripe to be remade.
Absolutely. This is totally the type of story. The mythos of Excalibur and The Sword in the Stone, Arthur, this is kind of like Jane Eyre or Julius Caesar. It's the type of story you can retell every 5, 10, 15 years. And we haven't had like a big Hollywood incarnation of that in a little while. And if you're going to base it on that animated film, man, I remember watching that animated film when I was like just a little kid and my mom had a Laserdisc player and stuff like that. But this is the type of one where it's got all these elements that would totally work in today's Hollywood, today's movie-going audience. It's sword and sandal. It's huge in scale. This is a nationwide type of epic sort of thing. You're going to have visual effects. You're going to have great battle scenes. You're going to have high action and drama. Great, iconic, age-old characters. Mm-hmm. This is definitely one you remake, so I'm totally on board for this. David, what do you think?
And we're also going to have a talking owl named Archimedes, a highly educated owl. I just recently rewatched this actually a while, and I love this film. It's an origin story, and we get to see Arthur. Arthur's not this, what they call him, Wart, you know, which is of course it's not a nice name. Constantly, he's not a strapping boy yet. He's lanky, he's goofy, he's awkward. He starts off as a squire, and then has to kind of learn from Merlin all these different ways of life, of culture, and even in the movie, Merlin time travels. We don't actually see the time travel, but he mentions time travel. And he's like, I've seen steamed locomotives and I've seen this. Mm. So there's time travel involved. I don't know if they'll actually use that in the live action, but I think that would look incredible. Amazing. Yeah, I'm excited to see it. I'm excited.
It's across the board. This is a big thumbs up for all of us. All right, folks, listen, as you know, what we do now every week is a little segment we called Opening This Week, where we highlight the films that are opening in theaters everywhere this week. We got four films this week. So we're going to cover two of them today and two more on Thursday. And the two that we're going to cover today are brought to you by our good friends over at AMC Theaters, where you can catch these films this week. We're talking about Pixels. We're talking about The Vatican Tapes. Ashley, tell us a little bit about them.
First up is the new Adam Sandler film, Pixels. When aliens intercept video feeds of classic arcade games and misinterpret them as a declaration of war, they attack Earth using the games as models. Knowing that he must employ a similar strategy, President Will Cooper, Kevin James, recruits his childhood pal, former video game champ, and home theater installer Sam Brenner, Adam Sandler, to lead a team of old school arcade players, Peter Dinklage, Josh Gad, and a military specialist, Michelle Monaghan, to save the planet. Pixels opens this Friday on over 3,500 screens. Next up is the supernatural thriller The Vatican Tapes, starring Michael Peña, who can currently be seen in Marvel's Ant-Man, Jaimin Hansu, and Doug Ray Scott. The Vatican Tapes follows the ultimate battle between good and evil. Angela Holmes is an ordinary 27-year-old until she begins to have a devastating effect on anyone close to her, causing serious injury and death. Holmes is examined and possession is suspected, but when the Vatican is called upon to exorcise the demon, the possession proves to be an ancient satanic force more powerful than ever imagined. It's all up to Father Lozano to wage war for more than just Angela's soul, but for the world as we know it. The Vatican Tapes opens on 400 screens across the country. John, what should people be excited about this week?
I'm honestly excited about The Vatican Tapes. Now, full disclosure here, I'm a bit biased. The director, Mark Neveldine, is a friend of mine and introduced me to my wife. So I am biased there. But Michael Peña, who we just saw in Ant-Man, love him in that. Jaimin Hansu, who is, I think, one of the most underrated and underappreciated actors in the business. He shows up in films like Guardians of the Galaxy and stuff like that, but you can put him in anything and he will make it pop and make it work. And this, I watched the trailer. I thought the trailer was genuinely creepy. I thought this didn't feel a lot like, because remember a couple years ago, we were like inundated with like possession movies, just inundated. It's been a couple of years, but it's honestly, for whatever reason, this one clicked for me. I'm looking forward to The Vatican Tapes. Pixels is one that I remember when we first heard the description about it, I thought, oh, this has promise. I was a little bit nervous about it because of the cast. I haven't liked anything that that Adam Sandler and Paul Blart have been in together yet. I haven't liked anything that they've done together yet. I've become more of a fan in recent years of Adam Sandler as a dramatic actor, actually. I think when he does drama, he shines. The dude is a star when it comes to dramatic acting. But I haven't liked any of his comedies in a really long time. The trailer worked for some people at this table, and it didn't work for me personally. So I'm actually going to go see Pixels tonight. So I'll let you guys know more about what I think about it later. I'm not super stoked about it, though, myself. Shep, I remember you liking the second trailer, especially when it came out. But are you looking forward to either of these films?
As long as Qbert has a very large screen presence, and as long as the movie doesn't end with those aliens playing like Space Invaders and Pac-Man, if it ends that way, I'm going to destroy something. I'm going to get incredibly angry. I might turn green. But yeah, no, I'm still looking forward to Pixels. You know, it could suck. Or it could be amazing. It's really like that last trailer that I saw. I was like, wow, it's like some of those scenes didn't work and some, most of the scenes did.
I know a lot of people loved the second trailer.
Yeah, I was on the same camp. I love the second trailer, but it's Adam Sandler. So it's like, it really is that like, wow, you know, I just have to wait and see. So I'd be interested to hear what you have to say about it after you see it. But I'm looking forward to it. I'm going to see it on opening day as far as I'm concerned.
David, what stands out to you?
My love of video games will take me to see Pixels. You guys were playing The Witcher 3 back there. I put 103 hours into beating that game.
Oh, so wow.
While you're starting your journey, know that it will take you 100 hours to finish that game. So my love of video games take me there. I love the scene in the trailer with Pac-Man. and his maker, you know, going to him. Right. He's like, my son, you know. So it looks silly, but it could be funny. I was talking to Ashley earlier about some of our favorite exorcism based movies, and I know we're talking about the exorcism.
We sound so morbid right now. Our favorite exorcism based movies.
Yeah, we get here at 10 in the morning and talk about our favorite. Hey, what's your favorite exorcism movie?
Who's your favorite dead guy?
Yeah,
my favorite possession film is Rosemary's Baby.
So we both I think enjoy the genre. The trailer didn't grab me, but just because, like I said, because of Michael Pena, the cast, and just it does visually look like it could be scary. And that stuff for me, I don't know. It's weird because that stuff, it's like, it's not like aliens. Like maybe it's real, maybe it's not. You know, those possession stories are kind of freaky because on some of those stories, they actually have like footage. This isn't one of those, but it's just kind of scary. So, I mean, I'm definitely going to check out both. But I think I'm more excited about Pixels because of video games.
All right, folks. Well, we've reached that time of the show for Mailbag. Listen, if you've got a topic or a question you'd like us to address on the show, you can email us anytime at collidervideo@gmail.com. Just send on in your questions. 24/7, doesn't matter. We'll see if we can get your question on either Movie Talk or on Mailbag on the weekend. So, Ashley, what do we got?
Donovan Barner writes, some film reviewers on YouTube call film in Hollywood a business. Consequently, many have failed to remember that film is a superior art form that transcends the business-driven economy that is Hollywood. I would love to hear your take on whether films are best suited as art forms or business ventures. Thank you all so much for the content and stay saucy.
This is the constant eternal struggle, both amongst in the industry itself and amongst fans, is Hollywood an art, or is Hollywood a business? And my contention has always been, why are the two mutually exclusive? It is not either or, it is both and. Hollywood is an art and Hollywood is a business. There are those out there who want you to look at Hollywood as nothing but a business. It's all about dollars and cents. There are those out there who just want you to see the filmmaking is nothing but an art and whatever. It reminds, you know, think of a cocktail party and you got the guy, short little guy in a business suit, walking up to the artist director in a coiffed hairstyle with a little scarf around his neck. And the little guy says to him, hey, I understand you're putting in a request for you want to make a $125 million movie? What's that about? And the artist then goes, it's about a butterfly who flies into the sun and emerges on the other side as a caterpillar. It's an allegory for our socioeconomic times and the diversity between the classes. It's going to be brilliant. Okay, yeah, that sounds great. And who's going to pay for this? Don't be silly, little man. You're going to pay for it. I'm an artist. Artists don't pay for things. No, I often find when I talk to people who just side on the business aspect, it's like they forget that good art is good business. Like there was a number of years ago, going back a while now, like when comic book movies were spit out now and again and stuff like that, where they thought, just put out any piece of crap, it's a comic book movie, it's going to have its audience. What Hollywood started to learn was, it's like, hey, wait a minute. The better we make the movies, the more money they make. It's like they started to put that together. Good business is not divorced from good art. But at the same time, I talk to people who just say business should stay out of it and whatever. Just, you know, buy my house and then don't ever step foot in it. Like it's sometimes on the artist side, it's like they totally just want to pretend like the economic realities don't exist because it's easy to pretend that way when you're not the one who's paying for anything, when you're not the one who's cutting the checks and you're the one who's losing $40 million on a film or whatever. To me, Hollywood is not an either or, it is a both and. I don't know, David, how do you see it?
No, I completely agree. I think people have this whole, conception of like the evil executives and people like sitting in this boardroom just staring down like, you know, fail, 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 you know, no money. But it does when it's beautiful when it works together. Now, the more power you have in Hollywood, sometimes you have more pull. Like if you're a James Cameron or a Christopher Nolan, sometimes, you know, like, okay, hey, if you do The Dark Knight for us, you know, we'll give you Inception. We'll finance that. If you do the third Batman, you know, Dark Knight Rises, we'll let you do Interstellar. You know, sometimes you have to make some deals, but at the top level, you know, you can have both. It can work. I mean, look at like a small movie, Black Swan. Did very
yeah,
well.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Last did one did very well. And that was, you know, a very small film, but it actually did well, made a lot of money. So when it works together well, I think it'd be a beautiful thing. It doesn't have, I think when you put that dollar sign on it, people believe it taints it. It's right. Tainted somehow. But when you're an author, you're Stephen King's not going to write a 1,000-page book and just keep it for himself. Like no one's going to read it. He wants to release it, not just to make money, but to share his art. Art is great when it's interpreted and shared with other people. You don't want to hide it.
Schnapp.
I 100% agree, but then also let's look at Noah.
That's a movie that was also artistic and experimental, but it cost millions and millions of dollars and didn't make that money back.
Yeah.
Henceforth, business equals meeting art at a failure point. I liked Noah a lot, but if I was the person who put all that money in, I'd be really pissed because I would have now been bankrupt. So it's sort of one of those things where, you know, if you're making an artistic venture, you have to be able to make it for less money because it might not be as smooth and homogenized as a lot of other larger films are. And homogenized is not in a bad term. It's a way that so that most more people can see it as opposed to a selective group of people. So if you're targeting a selective group of people, you can be a little bit more experimental. You could take more risks. And you, it, as long as it doesn't take as much money because of the way that these movies and television, all entertainment pretty much is both art and business. Mm. It's the great mixture of the two. And you get people who are elitists on both sides and argue both sides. I've been in rooms pitching a show with people who just have blank looks because they don't get what I'm talking about. So you have to find the right way to talk to everyone.
That's you and me every morning.
Yeah, that's me. That's Camp here. I'm like, listen, John, I'm trying to, he's like, yeah, just pretty eating much. Some chocolate, watching a Star Wars Rebels episode. I don't know what you're saying, Schnepp. What are you saying? Chocolate dripping. That's not how
it works. Hashtag chocolate dripping.
John, is it exhausting for you when you were making your documentary to go through that process? I mean, how was that? I mean,
here's the thing. It wasn't exhausting for me for that part of it because since we crowdfunded it, we didn't have to go through that aspect of it. It was more like communicating to the people that we wanted to interview. So that's a totally other question. But as far as the business meeting art, it is a true merger that you have to have. You have to be able to make compromises if you're going to make a larger type of a film, because those are the risks that you're going to have to take. You have to where everybody has to work together. If you're like going to be like that guy who's like, I have the butterfly, whatever, do that accent.
I'm an artist. I don't pay for guffaw.
I got $1 million. If you can make that movie for $1 million, we got a deal.
See?
Yeah.
We got to do a podcast of just those two characters.
I'll be teased. I got a little man in my stomach there, Frenchie or whatever accent you got there. I'm going to put $1 million on that butterfly, snowflake, sun thing that you're talking about. I like it. $1 million, nothing more.
Guffaw. Okay, what's next?
Chase Foster writes, y'all rock. My question is about the rating for next year's Suicide Squad. What are the chances this will be an R-rated movie? I figured based on the fact that this story follows villains, a scene where Joker tortures Harley Quinn, and David Ayer's history of directing R-rated films, that this might have the chance of being R-rated. Am I crazy for thinking that WB would even consider doing this, or is there a reasonable chance this could happen? Anyway, thank you guys for all that you do.
Two sides to this. Number one, don't underestimate how much you can actually get away with today in PG-13. You can do a lot in PG-13 and get away with it. Now, at the same time, though, we now live in a world. Look, it's often like, who's going to be the first penguin to dive in the water to see if there's a seal waiting there to eat you? You ever see those pictures? Like 100 penguins needing to go into the water to try to find some fish, but they're waiting for the first one to go in to see if there's a seal there, right? Deadpool was that penguin. Deadpool took the dive into the water. Now, I know there have been R-rated comic book stuff before, but nothing in this modern age of shared universes and all that kind of stuff. One of the things that I always thought would be hard to make a Deadpool rated R film is that if they have plans to mix Deadpool in with X-Men, if they have plans to mix in Deadpool with a PG-13 universe, it makes it a little bit tricky. But Deadpool is the first guy to dive into the water to see if we can make this work. And now that the first penguins dived in, look, I still think they're going to do Suicide Squad PG-13. They're putting Batman in it. They want it to be very marketable. They want to do all that kind of stuff. But I don't think you're crazy for thinking that they at least consider it or did consider it. I mean, the movie is pretty much shot now, so it's going to be whatever it's going to be. But I don't think you're crazy for thinking that at some point the execs at WB at least considered it. And if Deadpool works, and by working, I mean the business side, if Deadpool makes money, you, I think, are going to see a lot of studio. You're going to see Fox, and you're going to see maybe even Marvel. That's hard to imagine. But certainly a WB with their universe, maybe sit back and go, maybe we can consider R-rated stuff. So will it happen? I don't think so. I think Suicide Squad will be PG-13, but I don't think you're crazy for thinking they considered it. Schnepp, what do you think's going on there?
I personally think never would Warner Brothers take any of their DC characters. That's why I think they spun that Vertigo. Remember, they separated a couple weeks ago. They were like, look, this is where Sandman and these other characters are going to live. and they can be R-rated.
Mm, good point.
I think Warner Brothers, specifically Batman, Superman, Wonder Woman, all their main core, their superhero characters will always be either PG or PG-13. The minute they go to R, it's gonna upset that balance, I think. Personally, I think I don't see Marvel, because especially now that they're owned by Disney, I don't see that happening either, them pushing past a PG-13, because I agree with you. Yeah. There really isn't a reason within this, except for like super rare ones like Deadpool, which makes sense to push those boundaries. And it's cool that Fox is taking that risk. But once again, Fox is not affiliated with Disney. So there's these ramifications that happen to the, you know, we were talking about business and art. There's the ramifications that happen. Like, look, we don't want all these angry parents coming at us and creating all the, you know, so there's a lot of like things that you're not considering when you're like, I want it to be like this and it should be real and this and that. You can get a PG-13 rating and still have Suicide Squad. You can still have death, murder, you know, explosions, but it just, you might not just be seeing somebody's face getting peeled off, you know?
Once again, you just described the scene here in the offices every day. All right, David, what do you think?
Well, I don't want to necessarily see a rated R, especially like Justice League, let's say, you know, nothing, that's not going to happen. Like, I agree. I don't think it's ever going to happen, but when you do something rated R, you have to make concessions. You have to drop your cost. I mean, I know when Vin Diesel did the new Riddick film, I know he had to like take a mortgage out on his home. He said if that failed, he would have been close to, he would have probably had to file for bankruptcy. Wow. So I remember he said he wanted to be rated R, no questions asked, like, okay, we'll give you 30 million. Did you rate it R? If you got to do PG-13, we'll give you more money. I know Ridley Scott for Prometheus wanted somewhere over $200 million rated R. No, we'll give you 100 something. We're not going to give you $200 million. So I want to see a little bigger budget. I want to see the huge special effects and the bit. I want to see as much money into the film as I can. Not that money makes the film better, but in those big epics, I want to see that. So if they're going to make a rated R, they're going to have to drop the budget on it. And I don't think I want to see that. For Deadpool, it's okay, but not for one of the big crossovers.
Well, they're not spending $120 million on Deadpool. Exactly. So that's gonna be, it's going to be really interesting to see what a major studio, this is one of a million reasons I'm excited about seeing Deadpool, but a big major studio taking a comic book character, making the movie for like $40-30 million budget, and see how it does. I think there's a lot of reasons. The rated R thing, the budget thing. I think a lot of people are watching this movie with a lot of anticipation to see how it kind of evolves. All right, what's next?
Jen Kang writes, greetings from Australia. I'm really enjoying the show. Ever since the Twilight series, it seems every single bestseller novel for young adults is being made into a movie, and I'm wondering how long would this trend last? Because I'd love to see classic novels like Don Quixote, Crime and Punishment, and The Adventures of Tom Sawyer on the big screen instead. Cheers and keep up the good work.
Well, once again, this isn't really an issue of an either or, but probably more along the lines of a both and. Like, yeah, we have gotten a number of these, you know, teen novels to movie adaptations. But really, when you sit back and think about it, it feels like there have been a lot of them. There really haven't been that many. And the fact is, they haven't been knocking it out of the park necessarily. Like, yeah, you've got yourself a Hunger Games franchise, but the Divergent series isn't doing marvelous. When you look at that one by, I never pronounced her name right, Saoirse Ronan, with The Host, the one written, David was pointing out to me earlier, written by Stephanie Meyers from Twilight as well. That movie bombed terribly. You had The City of Bones, which
City of Suck,
as Schnepp affectionately calls it. But also remember, there are a lot of movies that get produced. And just because they went ahead and produced The Host, just because they made City of Suck, that doesn't mean that, hey, you know, if they didn't do City of Bones, they would have done Crime and Punishment. It's right. Not an equation. It's not like saying if they didn't make The Host, they would have made a Tom Sawyer movie. They're not necessarily connected that way. So I don't think we're going to see a long trend of these teenage things translated, because other than a few big hits, we're not seeing it translate well. So I think that trend is ending, and it's never been a big trend anyway. And also, don't fall into the mistake of thinking that the two are completely connected. I don't know. Schnepp, how do you see it?
Yeah, I agree. They're not connected really at all. I mean, I think what we're seeing is that Ron Howard film based off of Moby Dick, but it's called, what is it called? It's the one with Chris Hemsworth.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I can't remember.
The Deep Beyond, or it's got some weird.
That was supposed to.
What is it?
What's that?
Heart of the Sea,
which was supposed to come out this summer, right. Got pushed back. Yeah.
So we're always going to see adaptations of classic novels, but that's totally different than the young adult novels. It's just different.
Yeah, I was going to say the staying power is there. I mean, we're getting a new Frankenstein, right. You know, that's coming out. That looks interesting. I think one of our old colleagues, Roth, got to interview the two, Daniel Radcliffe, Harry Potter,
right.
is going to be in it. And so I think that they're never going to go away. We're always going to get those. We're going to get Pride and Prejudice every 10 years. You know, we're going to do one of those. And they're going to see miniseries on TV. Maybe we'll see a Don Quixote miniseries on TV. I don't think these big, famous, these stories are going to go anywhere. We're always going to see them. They're just going to be maybe interpreted in a different way.
Sure.
Which is good. It's a good thing for creativity. It breeds creativity.
And I think I heard recently that Don Quixote might actually finally be getting some movement.
Oh.
Because I know they've been right. trying forever.
Yeah, Terry Gilliam will not stop trying
There's
to make
even
that
a documentary
film.
That's basically a Death yeah. of Superman Lives What Happened kind of version of Don Quixote. And I can't remember the name
so
of the documentary.
Lost in La Mancha.
Thank you.
It's a great documentary.
It's an excellent documentary.
It's amazing.
And it does sound like they're finally getting some movement on that. All right, last question of the day.
Michael Brusen writes, hello, the awesome crew of Collider Movie Talk. I watch you every day before work. Not long ago, I watched Mad Max Fury Road, and I liked it so much, I went back and saw the original Mad Max movies that I never got around to seeing. My question is this. Have you ever watched a remake or a sequel that led you to the original one or an iconic movie that you just never watched?
Yes, and actually this is one of the big arguments I always have with people who say you shouldn't make remakes as it ruins the original. Remakes don't touch the original. The originals are still there in all their glory. It doesn't do anything. And if anything, this has always been one of my big arguments, is that, like, say for instance, The Ring, the original Asian version of The Ring, right? Most people in this country had never seen it, all right? When the remake came out, more people went back to watch the original one because they found out it was based on an original that was awesome, stuff like that, than had ever seen the film before. Mm-hmm. Look at The Departed as well, based on my all-time favorite cop film, Infernal Affairs, right? Nobody in this country had ever seen Infernal Affairs. And when The Departed came out, suddenly more people in our culture went back and watched Infernal Affairs than had ever watched it before because of the remake. Now, I had already seen Infernal Affairs, but a movie like 310 to Yuma, because I loved the new Christian Bale, Russell Crowe, 310 to Yuma. That's how I found out there was an original 310 to Yuma, and then I went back and watched it, and I really appreciated it. Another film, I saw the original Girl with the Dragon Tattoo before I saw the new version, but I went and watched it because I heard there was a new version coming out. So there's another example of like, oh, hey, these new ones are actually turning people on to the originals more than I'd ever seen them before. So yeah, yes, for me, like 310 to Yuma was definitely one because I heard that the movie is coming out. Girl with the Dragon Tattoo was one as well. And I think you can talk to most people in that time. What about you, Schnapp? What are some reboots or remakes that actually turned you on to the original?
A lot. It's hard to really think too, because I'm a big foreign film fan. So I've seen some. I've seen Let the Right One In. I've before they did the remake. So more recently, not that many, but I was trying to think of a few, and I can't.
Let the Right One In is another good one that there's a lot of people I've talked to who had never seen it, but because there was a remake version, they got turned on to it, went back and watched it for the first time.
Yeah, and I think it's always good. Like, I'll mention The Raid, because a lot of people who haven't seen the original Raids that's getting remade here in America, and I'm sure that will turn people on to go back and see the actual real Raid. I remember Jackie Chan, when I was in college, Rumble in the Bronx and all these things were coming out. And that's when a lot of Hong Kong cinema was just finally making it and everyone was getting interested in all of the original Jackie Chan, you know, Donnie Yen, all the original guys. So it was very exciting to see that happen.
What about you?
For me, it was Old Boy. Now, I didn't watch the Spike Lee joint. It was like you. I heard about the new one being made by Spike Lee, and I said, "Okay, let me go back and watch the original." I haven't seen the whole trilogy yet, but I saw at least for the Old Boy, the first one. Mm. I loved it. Mm-hmm. Saw Spike Lee one, not so much.
Right,
but
it was so bad.
Not so much. That was bad. But I think just hearing about films. Even I know the question also says just old films you've gone back and watched. I know Dennis and I were having a conversation about westerns, and we're talking about our favorite movie openings of all time. He said one of his was Once Upon a Time in the West. Sure. I'd never seen that, so I've been right now kind of on a western kick. I just watched Once Upon a Time in the West, and I love westerns. I can't wait for, of course, Quentin Tarantino's A Hateful Eight. That should be awesome too. I'm so into westerns right now.
Yeah,
it's always good to be inspired by old
movies. Once Upon a Time in the West is a great one. It's like I was actually in the car like 2 days ago, just thinking about that one scene where he captures the fly, and he's just then relaxing while he knows that it's captured.
Well, there's a scene. He shows up at the train station. He has water falling on his hat. Doesn't faze him. And after a while, time goes by. He takes his hat off and then takes a drink of water. Yeah. And he's just waiting for somebody to show up. It's just awesome. Yeah. It's great.
Yeah. And who shows up? Charles Bronson. With the harmonica. Yeah.
You guys brought too many.
All right, folks. That will do it for us for this installment of Collider Movie Talk. Thank you so much for joining us. Listen, don't forget, Lots of great films playing at AMC Theaters right now. Head on over to www.amctheaters.com for all of your theater showtime and, of course, your movie ticket information. Make sure you subscribe to this YouTube channel, keeping you up to date on all the new programming content that we put out all the time. I want to thank the people sitting at this table with me. First of all, sitting over here on my left, Mr. John Schnepp. Schnepp, where can people find you online? You
guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram, just at John Schnepp and at TDOSLWH. You can find my film, Don't Pirate It. It's an independent movie. I know everyone's pirating it and having fun with that, but remember, it's an independent film, so please go to www.tdoslwh.com and buy the film, either a digital download or a Blu-ray or a DVD. That money goes towards us, all of us who helped make the film. We're in debt trying to make that money back, so please support independent film.
Over here, Mr. David Griffin. David, where can people find you?
Find me a few places. At GriffinDE on Twitter. You find my writings on ScreenRant.com. And I'll also do some other video work myself with Dennis Zhang on Think Hero Pro.
And, of course, our lovely host today, Miss Ashley Mova. Ashley, where can people find you?
On Twitter and on Instagram, at Ashley Mova. Happy Tuesday, guys.
And you can find me on all the social medias on Facebook and on Twitter at hashtag Chocolate Chin, also at John Campia. That'll do it for us, guys. Thank you so much for joining us. My name is John Campia for Collider Video, and until next time, bye-bye.